मन्यते चाति मूढ़ तथा बद्धवद्भाति यो मूढ़दृष्टेः The chorus is having the feeling of a dirge. You know, you know what a dirge is, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So let's pep it up a little. Sanityopalabdhi swarupohamatma समस्तेषु वस्तुष्वनुस्यूतमेकम् समस्तानि वस्तूनि यन्न स्पृशन्ति वियद्वत् सदा शुद्धमच्छस्वरूपः वेरी गुड एक्सलेंट सो We were in number 11, in the middle of number 11, correct?
Yeah.
Samasteshu vastushu anusyutam ekam. This word anusyutam has a very nice quality to it. Anusyutam means threaded through, linking everything, that which is the being of everything, the content of everything. And none of these meanings do justice. Because threaded through means there are certain separate things that something is threading through. And even if you have the yarn making the fiber, then that is also problematic because then there is the warp and the weft and all these things. So these are just ways to understand something that can be not be separated from which at all, which is totally, totally, you know, like we have seen in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad we are seeing, you know. Sarpihi from the milk, you cannot from the yogurt, dadhiniva sarpihi from the curds, the yogurt, you cannot separate the butter. You cannot say butter is here. This only in this portion butter is, and in that portion butter is not. Even if you bring baby Lord Krishna and say where is the butter, he will say give the whole, give me the whole pot right now. He's going to say, baby Krishna is going to say, you know, I want the entire pot to come with me because the whole pot of curds is full of butter, you know. Let my digestive system extricate, you know. Let that extricate. Why are we worried about extricating it? So the word anusyutam, come forward. Let us, yeah, come this side, yeah. Kate, you can move forward a bit, yeah. Come forward here, sir. Yeah. So therefore, we have this whole thing of, you know, from the butter you cannot remove, you know, from the curds you cannot say this is the area of the curd that has butter. Can you say that? No? What about in skim milk? You know, we are not talking of skim milk, okay? This is a new thing. Yeah. There is only one kind of milk in ancient Lord Krishna times. That was the milk with full fat milk. You know, that's why baby Krishna, baby Rama, they're all nice and pudgy like babies should be. They're not, you know, skinny and, you know, with ribs coming out, you know. That's not how it is. And even baby Ganesha, you know, even of course Ganesha did not outgrow that, but even Ganesha you find, you know, that is the Purnatvam, the wholeness. So here, that is what is talked about, Samasteshu Vastushu, in all things which is there, everything has, you know, this Atma, this whole truth of the universe is in every single thing. You cannot separate it. Like you cannot take out the curds from the milk or the yogurt, and you cannot take out the fire from the wood. Fire is, you know, as a potential it is present, and you cannot take out the oil from the sesame seed. You know, you cannot separate that. You cannot say which part of the sesame seed has oil and I want the non-fat part. You cannot say that. The whole seed is oil. It's nothing but oil. So just like the oil pervades the seed and the butter pervades the yogurt, this Atma Tattva, Satchidananda, which is here called Nitya Upalabdhi Swarupaha, pervades the whole, you know, all the things in the universe. So when you say flower, and so does you know, Bhagavan, which is the name here for, what is the name for Bhagavan here? Nitya Upalabdhi Swarupaha Atma, that Atma which is Bhagavan, does it pervade the flower or not? Yes. So we have to say flower is Bhagavan, but you cannot say Bhagavan is only flower, because then Bhagavan is also another flower, and then one more thing, and then the Bhagavan is also non-flower, and Bhagavan is, you know, the tree that bore the flower is also Bhagavan. Bhagavan is everything. So therefore, so that we don't have that hani, that loss of limitlessness, what do we have to say? That everything is Brahman, derives its being from Brahman. Brahman is beyond everything. That's what you mean by beyond. Beyond doesn't mean beyond time, you know, beyond time, beyond space doesn't mean beyond the Jagat. No. It is its own Shakti has, in the form of the Goddess, has brought the Jagat. The feminine energy has brought the Jagat and is keeping the Jagat awake and going. And then what? And then when the Jagat finishes, it will collapse back into Bhagavan. That Bhagavan is, you know, is everything in the Jagat, cannot exist without Bhagavan, but that Bhagavan is separate and uniquely, you know, himself, meaning that what we said, you cannot say that pot can exist without clay. You cannot say that. You know, from the standpoint of the pot, clay is needed, is completely intrinsic to the existence of the pot. But from the point of view of clay, the pot comes and goes, it's incidental. Lid comes and goes, pot comes and goes, another pot comes and goes. So therefore, this is the basic difference, okay? So then, Viyadvat, so see, you cannot really compare Atma to anything. Because for comparison, minimally you need two things. You know, that's the basics of comparison. Anybody disagrees? Okay, good. So minimally you need two things. You need two things to be able to compare. So Atma is like dot dot dot. Atma is like what? Anatma? No, you cannot say Anatma, because Anatma means not Atma. Atma is not like Anatma. Then Atma is like? That's all you have to say. Atma is like Atma. You cannot say Atma is like non-Atma, because everything that you compare, you know, the Atma with, there's only two possibilities. It's either a quote-unquote an extension of the Atma, where Atma is lending its existence in the form of that particular thing, or it, you can say from another standpoint, it is Anatma. So you cannot compare Atma to Anatma. And you cannot really compare Atma to Atma, because that's not really a comparison. So the Vedanta writers, they are always in a little bit of a tricky situation. And what is the tricky situation? Because they have to find one comparison. Then they settle down on space always. Yeah. Why space? Come on, don't be spaced out. Why space? Free of attributes and all pervasive. And then if there is atmospheric pollution, see nowadays we are talking so much about all these pollutions and ecology and everything. So there is atmospheric pollution. Too many cars on the road. In places in European countries, certain, you know, like Greece, you can have only odd number license plate endings on certain days and even number on certain other days. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, this, you know, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, that, like this they have. And so, because the pollution is so much, and then you say, I can see the smog. If you climb on a hill, and then you see the smog, is space affected by the smog? his face starting to cough and put a kerchief in front of his, yeah, so his mouth, its mouth, and say, oh my God, too many cars, I'm dying here. No, space is not affected. And similarly, you take another thing, you take hing, you know what is hing?
Ground ups for cooking.
Yeah, that what is your asafoetida, barangay, with that asafoetida, you know, you take this asafoetida, you know, and put it in one dabba, okay, any dabba you take. And then you close the lid on it, you know. Just keep it for 15-20 minutes. Not even 15-20 days. 20 minutes you keep. And then after that, you cannot, I assure you, I can give you this in writing if you want, you cannot use the dabba for anything else except asafoetida. Why? Especially if that that hing is strong. If you get that, hing means it's a resin from a tree. It's a digestive resin. Used in Indian cooking, and especially if it is strong, you know what happens? It comes in a solid form, and if it's pure, it has pervaded the entire dabba. You know, yeah. Huh?
What is a
dabba? A dabba is a small container made of steel.
Yeah, this is.
Show her that. That's a dabba.
Okay.
It's like Atma, it is behind you, it is in front of you, but you don't know it. So now you know dabba?
Yes.
Yeah, so that is dabba. So you keep, you know, go home and try this experiment. You keep the hing in a dabba, and after that you cannot use that dabba for anything except hing, you know. So then, now when you close the lid of the dabba, there is two things in the dabba. What is there? There is hing. And what else is there?
Space.
Ah, very good. Space is there. Dabba space is there. Like what is dabba space? Like what is inside this pot now? Pot space. Pot space, right?
Right.
Inside there is space. You cannot, you know, you cannot say there is no space. There is space, you know. To have one sip of water, there is that much space. You know. So, then this is called pot space. Space obtaining inside a pot is equal to pot space. Space obtaining inside a dabba is?
Dabba space.
So now in the hing you have two things. You have, you know, in the dabba you have two things. You have hing and then you have dabba space, both together, correct? So now the whole dabba is, what should I say? Its whole life story is done, you know. It doesn't have any other shot at being a container for anything other than its the asafoetida. But do you think that the dabba space is affected by the smell?
No.
No. Safe answer. No. But the air is affected. Yeah, we are not talking of vayu. We are talking of viyat, which is space. Air, of course, has to be affected because it is carrying the fragrance. For people who think asafoetida is fragrant. So, so that is the thing. So, you see, it affects the dabba, the container itself is affected. And sometimes it is corroded if the hing is strong. That's why they say never keep hing in plastic dabba, you know. Because it corrodes. Like certain things should not be kept in plastic. If you ask a person from Eugene their opinion, they will say, how do you spell plastic? So they don't know the meaning of plastic even. But for the rest of us. So certain things like turmeric should not be kept in plastic. If you tried and everything, it just becomes horrible. And this fellow also, the asafoetida, must not be kept in plastic. Very bad, you know. And for the plastic, that also. And so here, the dabba is affected. The atmosphere in the dabba is practically unbreathable because the asafoetidic fumes have permeated the entire dabba, but the dabba space has escaped this, correct? This is what, so viyadvat sada. So anything may happen to the body, mind, sense complex. The body may be, you know, ailing, flailing, I'm saying, not feeling good today, horrible, I don't like this, I don't like that, nothing is going my way. And then what? Of course the mind joins, otherwise it's no fun. You know, the mind is like a, you know, the guitar, that it's an accompaniment to the body. And it starts to sing sad songs. Why only I get sick? Why other people don't get sick? Why only I have this bad karma? Why me? That is the chorus, you know? Why me, why me, why me, why me? Not by me. Why me, why me, why me, why me, why me, why me, why me? This is the chorus. In various ragas the mind sings. And then what? The senses also join. I don't feel like eating today. I am not hungry, prana is joining, senses are joining, nothing looks good, I want to get into bed and not get out. I am depressed, I am oppressed, I am repressed. And then what? So the Atma is the last one to join, correct? Then finally Atma says, forget it, all these people have joined, I am also going to join. Viyadvat sada, vat means like. Viyadvat, like even space, which just does not join in this, you know, in this corrosion of the dabba and the atmosphere, because you have kept some strong smelling food item in it. Similarly, the Atma does not join the bandwagon of the body-mind-sense complex. Sada, when? All the time. Achcha swarupaha. Achcha does not mean a sneezing sound. Achcha is actually, we say in Hindi, kaisa hai? What will you say? Bahut achcha hai, that is achcha. Achcha swarupaha means immaculate, achyutaha. That chyutihi navidyate, that which does not come down and decline from its place. That's how the word achcha in Hindi has come from this only. Achcha swarupaha, whose nature is never to come down, never to go away from itself. Very, very beautiful. And so this is, what is this? What are we describing? Nitya upalabdhi swarupaha aham. Don't say this is Atma. Who is this Atma? Aham. You have to own it up. And now for the final thing. Upadhau yatha.
Upadhau yatha.
Vedata sanmaninam. तथा तथा भेदता बुद्धि भेदेषु तेपि यथा चंद्रिकाणां जले चंचलत्वं तथा चंचलत्वं तवापीह विष्णो
तवापीह विष्णो.
Yeah, very nice. And it's the final one here. And what does the final one say? You know, there are two rulings on this final verse. Some people's opinions. And what is the opinion? You became all pervasive? You are all here? And here also?
Transition.
Okay. So, that's what we were talking about. Anyway, so, there are two opinions about this verse. And what are the two opinions? The first one is that this Hastamalaka is telling this to Adi Shankara, just like the other verses. The first, you know, there is Kutadvayam, there are two opinions on this. Scholarly opinion is divided. And the second opinion is that this is Adi Shankara's response, you know. I tend to not think so, because it goes in the same tenor. Just because it doesn't end with Sanityopalabdhi Swarupohamatma, that's not enough evidence for us to see or to think that the speaker has changed. So let us look at it both ways. So because that tradition is there, Upadhau means with reference to the Upadhi. You know, Yatha Upadhau, let us look at the Anvaya. yatha upadhav, just as in the presence of the upadhi, with reference to the upadhi, bhedata sanmaninam. Bhedata means the difference in the crystal beads. What is this crystal beads and upadhi? Behind the crystal beads, let's say if the crystal beads, a mala of crystal beads is worn by someone who is wearing a white shirt, what will the crystal color look like?
White.
Then they take out the mala, they remove the mala and give it to somebody wearing black shirt. Mala becomes
black.
Then red one, then yellow, then blue. Then the mala is taking on all these colors. Is it really taking on? No. As though taking on. So the various colored t-shirts which become the background to show off this crystal mala become the upadhi for the mala. And what is the mala's real nature? Free of upadhi, free of coloration, free of attributes. And so too when the mind, the mood also sometimes is like that. Sometimes it is blue. You say, I feel blue. And sometimes it is jet black. Don't wake me up. You know, sometimes it is red, angry. And sometimes it is light blue, very pleasant. Sometimes it is yellow, bright like the sun. And sometimes it is just grey, like outside. Drab and grey. So this is just the various colorations of the mood. And the Atma, which brings each one to light, is itself free of being any color. Even though it seems to go along with the mood, because it doesn't oppose the mood, it really does not partake or participate in this coloration. Similarly, it doesn't participate in the body, it doesn't participate in the senses. So the changes are all at the level of this, you know, at the level of the body-mind-sense complex. And we have seen this at length. So, upadhav yatha. So, yatha upadhav, just as with reference to the upadhi, sanmani naam bhedata, the changes in the color is because of the crystal beads, tatha bhedata buddhi bhedheshu te api. And now the boy is telling Adi Shankara, for you are also appearing differently in the presence of different minds. Yeah, you also appear differently. To my parents, you were the last resort because nobody could make me talk. You were the one who made me talk. Maybe even for me, you are the last resort because, you know, I'm a big misfit in my own family. And somebody else sees in you a stern sadhu. Somebody else sees in you a very compassionate sage. Somebody else sees in you just some swami going, you know, clad in orange. Why? Based on the maturity and based on the coloration of their own minds and based on the mood in which they are in. So really when you see somebody, and this happens all the time, when you look at somebody, immediately the mind goes into overdrive. Oh, doctor, lawyer, what are they doing? Oh, suit, okay, maybe professor, okay. What do they want? How, you know, where do they work? Immediately we start making inferences, and those inferences may have nothing to do with that person. They all have to do with our own projection of what a doctor, a lawyer, a homeless person, you know, anybody who is in any particular profession should look like. We have our own stereotypes and that are very deeply based. So here also he says that buddhi bhedata bhedeshu, and he says two things here. One is the same Atma appears in different buddhis differently, and so too for you. And also the same you are neither sage nor monk nor anything. You are Nitya Upalabdhi Swarupa Atma, but you are seen as the sage by various buddhis who look at, who are able to see only so much. That is what he is saying here. And te api means in your case also, you appear differently. in the presence of different minds. And then you can also take it in a different way. The you here is what? The I that was talked about earlier, Nitya Upalabdhi Svarupaha Atma, that I appears differently in different minds. And since it's a conversation between Guru and Shishya, you appear differently in different minds, it is being talked about. And then, very beautiful, that's why it's so deep, and we cannot do this without unpacking the Sanskrit, you know. Yeah, and then he gives an example. We have already seen this example in detail. Yatha chandrikanam jale chanchalatvam. Chandrika is the moonlight appearing on the surface of the water. And I told you a story. What story I told you? Yes, baby Lord Rama. One day he has a terrible, terrible, you know, fixation. I want the moon, he says. He cries and cries and cries. And then what? Then somebody in the palace has an idea and brings one big parat. And then paratha is this big shallow plate, and then puts it in the royal courtyard. And the baby just goes and splashes about because the moon is now come here. And Lord Rama catches the moon with both his hands. And then looks, chanchalatvam has slipped away, again catches, again slips, again catches, again slips. And then he plays, and the moon is into million pieces. But then he looks up, the moon is one. Then again he looks down, the moon has got ripples on it. Then he looks up, the moon is whole. Then he says, oh, I just have to catch this. Looks like there are two. And he is not successful in catching it. And then what happens, you know? So, yatha chandrikanam jale chanchalatvam. That which makes the moon appear as though it is moving. And see, there are certain other examples as well. Like, you know, chandro dhavati. What does that mean? The moon runs. When does the moon run? When do you see the moon run?
You're running.
You have lived in Eugene too long. When do you see the moon run?
When
the clouds are running in front of the moon. See what I mean? You lived in Eugene too long. When the clouds are moving in front of the moon, sometimes it appears as though the moon has an appointment that it is late for and it is running to catch this appointment. So the moon running is an illusion, correct? So when you say chandro dhavati, the moon is not running. The clouds are, you know, moving in front of the moon. And it gives the feeling that the moon is running. So to hear, the mind is running with all kinds of thoughts. What to do today? What to do now? Who is this? Who is that? Why? Who? What? And then it's all just a thought. You know? So I'll just at the level of the thought is running, Atma is the stationary screen on which the movie in the form of the thoughts. Sometimes it's a sad movie. Yeah, all the inner children are crying. And sometimes it's a happy movie, they're all laughing. Sometimes it's a tragi comedy, little laughter, little cry. Sometimes it's a sick movie, sometimes it's a horror flick. Yeah. Things are scary in this movie. Atma is the screen, the unmoving, attribute-free screen upon which various movies are projected. So, tatha, you know, tatha chanchalatvam. So, if any aspect of you moves, O Guru, O Adishankara, you know, tatha chanchalatvam, tava api, iha Vishnu. Instead of saying Guru, he says Vishnu. Hey Vishnu, who is Vishnu? The all-pervasive one. He says that the seeming movement in you. And what was the movement in Adi Shankara? We know that Adi Shankara lifted him because he never stopped prostrating. He was on the floor and you know, chanting these verses. And he lifted him and embraced him. And so that was a movement. The lifting of this boy from the ground was a movement. He says, it's not you that is moving, it's the cloud. It's like the clouds in front of the moon, like the water reflected on the moon. You are all pervasive. You are neither stationary nor moving, you just are. You're not, you know, stationary is again a comparative thing. If something never moves, you don't call it stationary. It's a relative thing. This thing never moves, but at the same time it's all pervasive. What to call it? This nameless one, this formless one, which is the same I, which is in you. Hey Vishnu, you all pervasive one, or even Lord Vishnu, which means all pervasive one. Your movements are also nothing to do with the Atma. This is what the child says. Or we can take it, Adi Shankara says that. You know, it's like a concluding verse and the Guru gives his blessing and says, you know, this is what it is. But I prefer the first one. I prefer the first thing because it's in keeping with what has been talked about, the whole thing. So that concludes the Hastamalaka. You know, I'll take questions later all together. So we will say the chanting, the closing chant and go to Medha Suktam presently. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Don't go away, we are having Medha Suktam.